so this is another quick lesson, if you will, about music theory. So I'm working on a music theory book called Music is Numbers, and it's a comprehensive look at music theory, not just focusing on one instrument. That book is actually like a 3-in-1. It does talk about the guitar. It's a 4-in-1, sorry. It talks about the guitar, it talks about piano, and it talks about bass. There's a section in there that talks about the specific instruments, and I could have made a book individually, one for guitar, one for bass, one for piano. But essentially, the notes and the theory is the same. But anyway, and then the fourth part is the actual music theory part. In the most simplistic form for theory, it's simple. It's just numbers. But there is a lot to learn. And for someone to say that it's easy, that would be a lie. Because it's a lot of terms and a lot of things that I don't even know about that is not included in the book that I can't put in the book if I don't know the name of it. There's things that some guitar players do that are technique that I don't know what the name of the technique is. So therefore, I can't include it. They're doing something that I'm not understanding. A lot of guitar players are masters at mimicking another guitar player. So they don't know theory, but they can copy what someone did. That's excellent. So then, you know, you collect a library of these techniques, and you become a proficient guitar player that can do most things. But that wasn't my goal. My goal was to be able to know what I was playing and to be able to articulate that with other musicians, even though I don't really have an opportunity to play with other musicians on a daily basis, to be honest with you. But at least when I'm dissecting a song that's already created by another musician, I want to be able to know what they're playing and know how to either copy what they're playing or allow me to embellish on my original songs. In other words, if I don't know theory, then how can I dissect a song and then relay that to another musician or understand? So my journey may be different than others. I just watched a video that covered my plight, right? They cover the pitfalls of learning the wrong way and then starting all over. So I've started all over musically at least twice. This could be the third time that I'm starting over to try to get a better foundation. And that foundation is based on chords. And being more proficient with chording comes with soloing. And I needed arpeggios for that. So really, arpeggios and chords are the same. And then I can relate all that to numbers. Music is numbers, no matter how you look at it. You can look at it as notes. Those notes are relating to a frequency, and that frequency is relating to a number. So you can look at music as letters only, which are notes, and that's what a lot of people base their musical knowledge based on, the notes, which is good. And, you know, you can look at the circle of fifths and the circle of fourths and say, yeah, I know notes. But those notes are relating to numbers. So I look at music in both ways, but more importantly, I look at it as numbers, because the goal is chord progression. Once you understand chord progression, you'll understand that you're dealing with numbers. So I always want to start basic. So I said that this is a lesson. So this lesson that where I'm at, and then I'm going to give you a basic, I'm just going to give you a major scale lesson today, but I'm going to show you where I'm at right now. So I have a daily practice workout sheet, which there's no way that I can work on every item in this sheet because it's so much. It would take a couple of hours before I could actually complete everything unless I had some type of regimen. But the point is, I think on an everyday basis for the last few weeks, I have been rehearsing at least 1 hour a day. Now, you want to get up to like 2 hours a day, but everybody don't have that capability. They don't have that luxury of rehearsing. But I'm actually picking up the guitar every chance I get, opposed to all the many years where I was noodling. And noodling is cute. It's nice. It got me to where I'm at. I've recorded a lot of songs. I've dissected a lot of songs with noodling. But I'm tired of noodling. I want to know the chord progression. I want to know the theory behind the chords. And I want to know what I'm playing now. So therefore, that's going to take more time. That time people don't want to take and put in. It's an investment. The more I invest in the foundation and theory, the better player I'll be become. And then I'll utilize my playing by ear along with the theory. And then that should take me to another level. Or it will just improve my ear playing. Or I will transition to everything I play. I know exactly what I'm playing. It's either way. It's not a negative. So, the actual sheet I'm building will essentially become a physical sheet that I would print out, and I have a checklist. And the checklist can vary from day to day. You could say, well, I worked on this and that today. I worked on this and I worked on that, or I just worked on this. So going back to what I was about to say, where I'm at right now is called a... that's the thing. That's the confusing thing about music. It's more than one way to express is why that. Why? Because there's more than one genre of music. There's more than one style. There's more than one way to play something. That has made my journey so confusing on a guitar, because it's more than one way to play things. Even on the piano, you can play a chord in the root form, in the inversion. First inversion, second inversion, third inversion. You can do all different things for the same chord, and it'll give a different voicing. So that's what makes things kind of confusing. But here, something is called a minor 7 flat 5. So if you're dealing with a certain key or note, you would say a C minor 7 flat 5, which some people may call that an half diminished. A diminished chord is a 1, a flatted 3, 3rd, and a flatted 5. That's a diminished chord. So you could say the 7 in a major scale, the 7th degree, it is a diminished chord, but it doesn't have to be. You can sharpen the 5 or you can do other things, but then it turns into a different chord. So the minor flat 5, the minor 7 flat 5, the name of the chord and how to play it is in the name. It's minor, so we know it's a flat 3. It's a 7, so we know it's a flat 7. It's not a major 7. And then it has a flat 5. So it's three indicators. If you break it down, like, I don't edit my videos. I'm a video editor. That's what I do, but I just don't edit these videos because it would just take a lot of time. It would take a lot of space. So I don't think that my videos get enough sharing and liking because I'm not editing every video. I will get to that point, but right now it will just take too much time. But if I had a graphic, I would show you the division of that particular chord. It's a minor, so you can say minor, you know, M, and then it's a flat 7. That's a whole nother section. And then it's a flat 5. So we know that it's three different things going on in that chord. And obviously it's a 7 chord. So we know it's 4 notes. It's going to have a root. It's going to have some type of third. It's going to have some type of fifth. And it's going to have some type of 7th. I talk all about this in the book, Music by Numbers, that I've written the book. The book is written, but since the more I learn, the more I add to the first edition of the book. So you could say the book is completed, but what I'm doing is adding I'm adding significant information of things that I'm learning currently, And I'm also editing the book, meaning making corrections. And then I also, to be honest with you, I have to make sure I give credit to where it goes to, because I'm gonna gear it toward academia. So, you have to you have to put your resources, you have to label it. So I have to see how my book holds up with that. In other words, I've used other sources. Like if I use, let's say I use the definition from a dictionary, I want to make sure that I note that, right? Or let's say I got the definition or some type of information from another source. Usually it's an online source. I want to have that in the credits, so therefore no one can accuse me of plagiarism. Okay, so that means you're basically taking something from somewhere else. Yeah, that's what most books are. They're taking bits and pieces, but at the end of the day, this is an educational book, so you want to provide that. Now, it's going to be a lot of that. So there's software that you can use to check the level of plagiarism, but that's not the goal of the book. The goal of the book is to put as much information that I can in one book and make it make sense. That's the goal of the book. So if you go back to this minor seven flat five, a minor seven flat five, they call it a half diminished. So if it's a D, a chord, it would be a D minor seven flat five. And that seven tells you everything, because the seven part tells you that it's not a major seven, that is automatically known as a flatted seven. And then the flat five tells you that is a flat five. Now, I know how to play it on the root, the root being a fifth string. And I'm going to talk about that more in the book. I think I touched on it, but it's important because your shapes are different depending on where the root is. Now, the music, where I'm at musically is working on the guitar. That's where I'm at. But the book is not focused on the guitar. It may lean toward the guitar, but the same theory applies to the piano. So a minor seven flat five is the same on the piano than it is on a guitar. Why, you may ask? Because the piano is a stringed instrument. Look it up. The piano is an acoustic instrument. We have electronic versions of the piano, which is a string instrument. And then one will argue and say that a piano is a percussion instrument. It could be the same thing because it's striking the strings. And then when you do research, you'll realize that in jazz or just music early on, the piano was labeled as a percussive instrument because that's how they used it initially. However, it's melodic, it's a lot of things a piano is. So a piano is a stringed instrument. So those strings are getting struck by those little hammers, right? Those little foam type of hammers, or depending on what type of piano it is. So the notes are being hit, just like how when you plug it, the notes are being hit. Right? You've seen people play like this, right? You're striking the strings. So anyway, minor seven flat five is where I'm at, and I already showed you how to do that. You basically have the root, which is C, and then you go your other finger will hit the flatted seven part, and then you have the flatted five part, and then you have the minor third part. So out of six strings, you're only striking what is it? Four. One, two, three, four. And that's another thing you have to learn, that I have to learn, is what strings to hit and what strings not to hit. And then there's some crazy chords where they skip strings, and I think that that's just meant to say that this is the arpeggio of that chord, but you can't really stroke down and skip a string unless you just are skilled, where you can just stroke down and skip strings. But the point is, That's where I'm at. But I've been playing this chord a few months, but didn't know what it was called. I just knew the shape. But today I know what I'm playing now. It is the infamous half diminished chord. Now, why is it called half diminished? I might have explained this in the book. You can look it up. But a diminished chord is a flatted third and a flat five. So that's a diminished chord. Like I said, it's the seven. So why they call it half diminished, I couldn't tell you, to be honest with you, at this particular moment. So what would be a full diminished? A full diminished would be, you know, the flat five and the flat three. But, you know, by adding the flat seven, they call this a half diminished. And you can argue with me if you want. I love to correct information. So therefore, when I write the second version of my book, I can make corrections. That's what the revision is all about. But to avoid this video being too long, I'm going to start at the beginning and deal with what you should know in order to build to chords. You should know the major scale. So that's what the lesson is for today. So we're going to get into it. So let's deal with the key of C. I can pick any a key, but the key of C is just somewhere where it's good to start. You can start with the key of A. You can start with any key, but these are the keys that usually when you're a beginner, which this is what this lesson is really aimed toward. It's, my lessons are aimed toward a beginner who don't know anything about music theory. It's aimed for people who know music theory but need a new foundation. So that's where I fall. That's where I fall in. I'm not an expert guitar player, but I'm not a novice either. From my vast experience of playing a guitar, I'm still not at the level that I want to be. I'm probably never going to be a real good guitar player. I'm just being honest with you. My goal is to be able to play chords. My goal is to be able to play octaves. My goal is to be able to know what I'm playing. But other guitar players, they know all these tricks, they know all these techniques, and they can mimic other guitar players. That's just not me. Everybody's not the same. So I'm just being honest with my level of how I'm progressing. If I can play chords, and if I can identify the arpeggio for the chords that I'm soloing, I'm good. I'm good. And I also want to be able to play octaves better than I do now. If I get that, then I've reached my goal. All the other tricks and hammer-on pull-offs and raking, and it's a long list of techniques that guitar players do. To me, though, those are tricks, but they are labeled as techniques. I don't have all those techniques, to be honest with you. You know, I hear some crazy, incredible, beautiful things where people understand harmony and then they'll be able to take their solo and the solo sound like chords, and it's just incredible. I'm thinking of a guy, some random guy who did a cover of Never Too Much, and he was playing way better than I could play at this level of the game. I did touch on feel. The feel wasn't 100% there. It was more technical playing, like, okay, this is how you do that. This is, you know, it felt like, okay, here's that type of chord here. It wasn't soulful playing, but he had the technique down. And most guitar players, either they got the soul, the rhythm, and the technique, or they have, you know, they might be like me. They play less notes and less technical, but it's soulful playing. So it is how, you know, everybody's going to play differently. So let's get back started with the major scale. So in order to do a scale, you need to know what key or note you're in the signature. In this case, we said it would be C. So in a C major scale, and that's all I'm going to focus on today, is a C major scale. And that's what allowed me to do that minor 7 flat 5 because of what I'm about to explain right now. So we have a root, which is the 1. Remember, music is numbers. So we have the C. Now, some people look at music as notes and some people look at it as numbers. I'm going to give you both for this example. So C and then the 2. That would be D. one, two. So that's the second degree in the major scale, right? And there's different shapes, so I'm not trying to focus on teaching you the guitar, but it's a different shape. So this is one shape. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, one. That's a major scale. The theory behind the major scale is one, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Literally. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. That's, and one. That is the theory behind the major scale, period. But there's notes in between that will turn it into other type of scales, but there's other notes. Like there is such thing as a flat two. So it that's in between the one and the two. Then that two, and then there's obviously such thing as a, we don't call it a sharp two, it's just a minor third, and that goes right before the third. So that's one, flat two, three. I'm going up chromatically right now. There go minor third, and then there's a three. One, flat two, two, flat three, three. And then we have the four, and because three and four is right next to each other, there is no note in between. So there go the four, and then you have what they call a flat five, which I discussed in the minor seven flat five. You could call it a sharp four, but it's a flat five, but you can call it a sharp four. Then there go the five. There go a sharp five, or you can call it a flat six. It all depends on how you look at it. And this, a lot of this has to do with the circle of fifths. And I advise you to learn that, because I figured out finally how to use the circle of fifths. I knew what it was. It was in the book a long time ago, but now I'm more efficient in being able to write out the circle of fifths and how so many ways to use the circle of fifths. That's now my new foundation to teach new guitar players. You need to know the circle of fifths, period, because it's not hard to figure it out. It's just learning it and getting in there and understanding the relationship. It's all intervals. Once you understand the interval means the distance between one note to another. So that's why I'm going down chromatically right now. I'm not putting any spaces or gaps in between the major scale. That's what I'm doing now. And people who know music, they know that that's what I'm doing. All right, so we got the four, flat five, five. That flat five is also known as a blue note. That's a whole nother lesson, but that's known as a blue note, a blues note, a sweet note. You can have all kind of names in there. That's a flat five. And, you know, like I said, I have one camera view right now, but, you know, if I'm trying to teach the guitar, I would have multiple camera views. I have multiple cameras, but I'm just using an iPhone right now. But I would have multiple camera views so you could see where my left hand is and what my right hand is doing. All right, so we talked about four, flat five, five, sharp five, and then the six. Then we go to the flat seven. So we there you go. Then the flatted seven, right? And then the major seven. And remember, the flatted seven is a part of the chord that I'm learning today, which is that minor seven flat five. There go to minor seven. There go the major seven, and then back to one. All right, so going back to a major scale, we know the numbering. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1. Now, if you didn't notice that that's, you know, there's so many terms for it. I did a piano lesson years ago about this, and I don't want to mess the name of it, but it's something that vocalists would practice. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, di, do, right? So they're in different regions, they're going to call it something else different, some of these terms. Latido, latido, you know, I'm not caring about that. I want your ear to be able to hear it. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, di, do. Right? So that's the most important thing to gather from that. So that way, if you miss a note, you can hear it. That's not in that scale. That's not in that scale. I want you to be able to hear. That's a major scale, period. So then you go up, which they call it ascending, and then you can go back down. Notice I'm going slow. There's no need to go fast. So I've always advocated for a metronome, but never use one. So the way that I practice is using a backing track, which is almost the same thing. The backing track has a time, and then that's what I was doing. But now I've gotten in the habit of using a metronome. And this one is at 90. I had it at 80. So let's see if I can do it. I might can't. Let's see. See, I messed up right there, right? Thinking of too many things. Here we go. See, it's when I gotta start on the downbeat. That's what I'm listening for. I got it low in my headphones. Dun, dun. There we go. There we go. Now I'm going to do this scale differently. That's a vertical way. So the reason why I messed up is because instead of starting on the root again, descending, I just came right back down. I went. What I could have done is. In other words, I'm starting on the root to come back down. There's no wrong or right way, but the first time I did it, and I'm trying to listen to the metronome at the same time, I went 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Another way of doing that is starting on the root when I'm descending, which this is a better way to practice. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 1, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So that's what I didn't do when the metronome was going, but that's a better way to practice. Notice I did it on the way down. Come back down to the one, and then start it off on the one. Now, the other way is just going up and down. Let me see if I can do it. Right? So I'm just going back up and down. What I'm trying to do is force myself to go on the root, to start on the root. And now it's going to sound like this. Right, so it doesn't really matter which way you do it, but you're getting extra notes in there when you start back on the root. Okay, so you should be able to do it both ways, right? Because all it's going to do is going to improve your picking, because notice I wasn't using a pick. That's what I've been forcing myself also to do, is to use a pick. So my picking gets faster. I usually use my fingers, and that's how I play. I'm not going to be able to do a lot of tricks if I'm not using a pick, you know. So when I usually use the acoustic, I don't use a pick. And then, like I said, my style of playing is not lightning fast. I'm not trying to be a fast player. I believe speed will come from time. However, I don't think speed is automatic. You need to push yourself further to get the speed. In other words, you're going to get speed by two things: repetition and practicing it. You know what I mean? So I told you that tempo was at 90, that I can practice a scale, an arpeggio, a triad. And then once I get bored, that's my thing. Once I get bored at that tempo, now it's time to move up the tempo. Then you move it up. Then you move it up. Then you move it up, right? You progress. But when you first starting out, oh no, you're going to be doing 60 to 70 beats per minute. That's my foundation, not to try to go fast, to try to be more accurate. That's probably 50 to 40 beats per minute. And then there's other things going on that I'm doing without thinking. Palm muting. That's a part of my book that talks about it, especially if an acoustic guitar. And then on my other acoustic guitar, you see I have something wrapped around the neck that helps with dampening the strings. I just don't have one on here, and I should put one on here, so that way I don't want the strings to ring out when I'm doing those scales, especially with the open notes and open chord. See how that's ringing? So I'm muting as I go. And often I mute when I need it. I can hear the note ringing and it wouldn't make a big difference to anyone. And then I mute it before it gets out of hand. In other words, I'm not muting on every stroke. I'm muting as I need it. Piano, they have a pedal that's called a dampener, or it dampens the note so it doesn't ring out. It cancels the note, so it's the equivalence of that's the equivalence of it. Now right now I have reverb on the guitar, so you're hearing two things with this guitar. You're hearing it come from the microphone, and I can't help that. It's an acoustic guitar. That's what it's designed to do, but it's also going through a sound system. So that's why you hear the reverb. If I turn the guitar off far as the system, then the guitar would sound like this. Now the reason why I'm playing it through the system, because I don't always use the acoustic. I might use my electric guitar. So I'm using GarageBand just to amplify it through the system so I can record it through the phone. So it's kind of set up for both the acoustic and for my electric guitar. And so when you're doing the major scale, remember I'm talking to beginners, you don't want to just be mechanical all the time. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You want to change the order of that or stop midway. So what I'm doing is I'm going up and down the scale, and I'm not trying to stay within a pattern. Seven accidentally. Well, that will do is, if you know what the notes are, you'll be able to go straight to a four, and you'll be able to jump straight to a two and a five easier. But if you're mechanically going one, two, three, four, five, then that's how you're gonna solo. And to break that, I would suggest that once you know the foundation of one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, one, that you would first learn descending. One, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one. Once you get that mastered, then you, I just skipped a whole bunch of notes there. So that would be better to use with a backing track in that key. So I would put on a C. I don't even think I have one available. I need both hands. I would just put on a C major backing track that will stay in the key of C, that will not move out of that, and then you practice. And then you have to look at the song or the progression to make sure that it's diatonic, meaning that it's using the notes of the major scale. So the chord should have those notes in there. Hold on. So I was doing a minor accidentally. So that's a minor. So C major. Not a C major 7, but a C major. So you will have a progression that's using that chord in there. That way when you play the, even though there is a major 7 in there, it's just the scale. See, that's what I'm trying to work on. So it had every note in there, right? It had a one, which is the root. It's gonna have that, but it had a two in there. That's gonna be what they call a nine. That's a whole different type of chord. It has the major third. It had a fifth in there. It had a four in there, which is could be a suspended chord. Then it has a major 7. It had the 6 and it had the 1. So a chord like that would be a crazy chord. But that C major would be best fit to do a backing track. And you can always correct me if I'm wrong, but you can run the major scale over a C chord. But if it's a C major, major 7, would work as well. But notice there's a 6 in there. There's a chord called a major 6. So there is a 6 in there. So diatonically, it has a lot of the theory and numbers in the major scale in that particular scale. So what I'm trying to do is get myself out of scale playing and get into chord playing, meaning I'm playing the arpeggio. So the arpeggio of that major scale was 1 3 5 7 1. That's the major scale. Or you can just say the triad of that is 1 3 5. But there was other things going on, right? It's the 6. So you could look at that as a major pentatonic, a 1, 2, 3, a 5, 6, and that gives you a major pentatonic. So this stuff is chord play, learning what those chords are. I couldn't play a major 6 to save my life. I probably can play it, but don't know it offhand. What I know is just the basic major scale chording, which is, they call it a chord scale. So if it's a C major scale, there go a C major 7. I could have used a C major. Then a D minor, then a what is that? E minor. Right, there go the four. The F with a six, an F6. There go the G major, a G major six. So yeah, so I do know how to make, it depends on the root. So that's the root of the fifth string. But I meant to say on the sixth string root, I don't know how to do the major six. And then on there, so using the sixth string root G. So again, one, two, three, four, and I could have did the four this way. Right, so again, major major seven for the one. One, two, three, four, five, six. That's a minor seven. There go a major seven, but really the seven is a diminished chord, and then back to your one on the sixth string root. So that's what I know, okay, which is just running through the major scale. There were the two, three, four, five, six, and then that diminished, which is in this case is a B. So there's another way I can do it. I can do, they would usually fit, not usually, they often would put the minor 7 flat 5 there, so then I can play that here and then come right back to my 1. All right, so that's what this is all about, being able to play the chords in the scale. So the scale was, to recap, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's the notes. But the notes are also the chords. So in the case of C, it would be C major. So we're going to just play C major. Not C major 7. C major. Let me try. C major 1. D minor 2. E minor. E minor 7. I don't think I said that for D. D minor 7, it has a flatted 7, so I should have said that. E minor 7, because if I just did E minor, it would sound like that. If I just did D minor, it would sound like that, not like, you might not hear the difference, but those are two different chords. Here is the D minor, here's a D minor 7, it has a flatted 7. E minor 7, and then here is the 4, which is a F major. You don't have to play it here, you could play that F here as a 6, or you can play it as a regular F major. It's all about voicing and where you want, how you want it to sound. And here's the G major. It's more than one way to play the G major, which makes it kind of confusing. You can play the G major this way, and then you play, then you come back to your A. That was an A major. A minor, sorry. And then your B minor 7 flat 5. And that's the one that I'm learning on, if you didn't realize. And then back to your root, and I'm gonna make it a major 7. A C major 7. Okay, so that's the goal, is to be able to play the chord scale. Now, I'm not that good with the minor. The minor has its own scale as well. You could play a melodic minor, or you could play the minor, you could play the 1, you know, the 2, the flatted 7, you could play the 4, you could play the 5, you could play the sharp 5, you could play the flatted 7. So these are chords. So if you played, let's say, blues in a minor, and we use G as the reference, so let's say it's in G minor, that would be the one. That's the four. That's the five. Back to the one. So that's minor. So what I want to get, what I want you to get from that centering on the major is knowing the major scale, because the minor is made from the major. A lot of people started off playing minor only. Some people only play in reference to minor, which is beautiful if you can relate that to the major scale, because everything is based off the major. So I started learning how to play the minor first, the blues scale. And then I realized that a lot of this was based off of major. So now I think in the major way, not in a minor way. The minor is a part of the major. In other words, the second position, when we're dealing with the modes, the second position is minor. The second, third, and sixth is minor. So if you understand what I'm saying, I already told you that. So I said the one was major, right? The C major. And then I said the two is the D minor. And then I said the three is minor. And then the four is major. And then the six, which is that A, is minor. And then that seven, I said it was diminished, but you could use a major seven flat five diminished, because it has a root, a minor third, a minor fifth, and a minor seven. And then back to your one. Okay, so hopefully you got something from this lesson. It's not about one lesson fits all. It's about gleaming from the messages. That's what I, from the lessons, that's what I've learned to do using YouTube. Because a lot of these lessons, they're not thorough. They're not taking you from step one and then step two. They start you on step three, but you're not ready for step three. So then you got to go back and look at the other videos in order to understand what step three is. And some people can do that. They can learn on step seven and keep that when they need it. And then they start on step five, but they didn't have step six. You know, they're just basically cherry picking and they're learning, but they're not putting it all together. And then one day they can put it all together. That's one way of learning. Lastly, I will mention what I mentioned in the book. A house is not built that way, and nor is teaching built that way. You don't teach how to put a roof on a house before you learn how to put on the foundation. We don't learn words in school first. We learn the basic of what a word is made of, which is the alphabets, right? I'm sure that there's some progressive smart kid that did it in a different way. But in order to understand subtraction and multiplication, you had to be able to understand addition and subtraction. In other words, there is an order to this, and a lot of YouTube doesn't focus on the foundation. They start you on a level of 17 on an advanced theory, but you don't understand 1 through 16. So what I'm trying to do in my own lesson, me learning myself my own lessons, is to get that strong foundation before I move on to the next thing, until I move on to the next. I move too fast, you know, I move too quickly and never got a strong foundation of chords. And that's what I'm working on now. So hopefully this lesson was helpful to someone. I don't do quick lessons. I don't do 10-minute lessons and everything is in that 10 minutes. Yes, you can edit the video down. You can take things out. No, those lessons are quick lessons, and playing an instrument is not quick. You have to put in time. You have to get calluses. You have to get muscles, right? You have to memorize. It's work. So no, I don't do those quick lessons. If you're looking for that, you have a whole bunch of YouTube videos that show you a lot of information in a short minute of time, but you may not understand what the heaven they just talked about. So the major scale, again, to recap, is a theory based on numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. If you're new to guitar, if you're new to the piano, that's where I would start. It's the same thing with the piano. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1. There's no difference between that. And I'm sure that in a trumpet, you would play the scale. C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C. You would do the exact same thing. It might be a different note far as how you play it, but the scale would be the same. It would be the same theory. All right, so I'm out of here. I tried to keep the lesson within an hour. You know, the same type of timing that you would have in a real session. You would have probably a 30-minute to an hour training. So I felt that it would be appropriate to do the same thing on a video. A lot of people don't want to put in the time. You have to put in the time in order to get the results. When you're planting something, when you're planting something, you need to plant it, and it's not going to grow overnight. It needs to, you need to nurture it. So that major scale needs to be the first thing you focus on. I could tell you all the other stuff that goes along with it, and it's not going to help you. You need to first focus on step number one. Step number one is the C major scale. It's more than one way to play it. You got to find the different ways of playing the major scale. You can play it horizontally. You can play it vertically, up and down. So find your way of playing the major scale. And then when you get the C major scale, move on to another one. There go D. The shape should be the same. All right, I'm out of here. If this lesson was beneficial to you, please let me know. Like, share, subscribe. Have any comments? Leave the comments, positive or negative. However, we really like positive messages, but you know, some people will always look for the negative of something. So those are helpful if it's in a loving and professional way. All right. I'm Christian Robinson Music. Hopefully this helps somebody. Peace.